Good morning and welcome to the 31st meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We've no apologies this morning, and our first agenda item is to review correspondence received on the issue of the progress being made to implement the recommendations around deaths in custody. Now, members will recall that we took evidence from Jill Imrie to review the progress of delivering on the recommendations from the independent review of the Response to Deaths in Prison Custody report, and we then wrote to various organisations thereafter. And paper one sets out the details of this and the replies. So can I invite members to make any comments that you may wish to do, and I suggest in any case that we send copies of the letters to Ms Imrie for her information and reflection. So would any members like to come in? Russell.
Thanks very much, Convener. Now, Jill Imrie spent 2 years producing this report on deaths in prison custody. There have been around 350 in the past decade, around half of these by suicide or drugs. There's been another 11 since she was in here giving evidence, and her report contains 26 recommendations or advisory points. But 2 years later, only 5 have been implemented, and her main recommendation was for a new system to investigate deaths in custody. But crucially, she said that this wouldn't even be necessary if the Crown Office fixed what she saw as failings in the fatal accident inquiry system. Now, it's pretty clear from everything we've heard that the Scottish Government and the justice agencies involved aren't in agreement with her, but they just don't seem willing to admit it. She told us that she feels frustrated but unsurprised. She told us that she feels humoured and patronised. And in response, we wrote to the relevant agencies, the government, NHS, SPS, and we've now got the replies here. And if Jill Imrie was despairing when she came in here, I can only imagine how she'll feel when she reads these. And I ask myself whether these organisations actually listened to what she said to us. And of course they did, because she couldn't have been clearer. And by ignoring her explicit concerns in the letters, they essentially confirm exactly what she was saying. It took another organisation, the Scottish Human Rights Commission, who saw her testimony, who wrote to us unprompted and addressed her concerns and sympathised with her. And it's also notable that despite the Crown Office being subject to severe criticism by Jill Imrie in relation to FAIs, they didn't choose to write to us to state their case in response. Now, she also told me in reaction to a question I put to her that she'd be willing to extend her tenure on the Deaths in Custody group. And it's no surprise that the Cabinet Secretary's letter doesn't even address that specific point. And again, this confirms what she told the committee. So to summarise, I think we're all entitled to feel frustrated, humoured and patronised. It seems to have been a monumental waste of time, effort and money. And I just wonder what kind of message all of this sends out to the families of those who have died in custody. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you. Sharon, do you think you'd like to come in?
Thank you. I think my colleague Russell Finlay has actually mentioned most of the points that I would go on. Just going through the Cabinet Secretary's letter, there was a bit in it about the successive increases, and there was a mention of the resource had been increased by 60%. I think I'd probably want to know more information on that. On the 60% sounds really good, but if the budget wasn't there in the first place, was 60% actually enough? So was the original budget that was there enough? And did the 60% increase actually cover all the things that they would have had to have implemented in the first place? Again, she mentions things about recommendations being complex and, again, requiring resources. So, again, it goes down to funding. She's also mentioned about NHS and how they're going to have everything done by the end of 2023. So there's only 1 month left. So I would expect more an update on how they're going to achieve that, because basically we've got 1.5 months and the last 2 weeks will be Christmas holidays. So, again, no note on whether Ms Imrie is going to be staying on in her role, if she's been replaced, if the role's been ended. So information on that. She also mentions that she's had a meeting with Ms Imrie, and there was another meeting on the 21st of November with Mr Matheson. So again, did that meeting take place? What was the outcome of it? moving on to the letter from Caroline Lamb, there was a bit in it about, as Ms Emery noted, there was no timescale set for the implementation of the recommendations. Well, I would imagine that the chief executives get paid a lot of money, so why did they not put in their own timescales? So again, it seems bizarre that we go and bring in a report with all these recommendations, but then we sit and say that there's no timescales when they're going to be implemented. So again, what was the reasons for her not just putting in their own timescales? But she's now put in that it's going to be by the end of this year. So again, moving on to the report that came in from the Scottish Prison Service, they gave us an action plan. But one of the things that I kind of noted all the way right through was everything that they were working on along with the NHS. One of the columns says what action's getting taken in the next 2 to 3 months, but there's nothing in it. So we finish in a month and a half as the end of the year. So I would have expected to see all the actions that were happening with SPS and the NHS, because they've basically got 6 weeks or whatever to go and implement all this, but there's nothing in their action plan. So I would have expected more in the Prison Service Action Plan. And that was my comments for just now.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, thank you. Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Just to put into context some of the things we've been hearing, that there is a pilot project which was started in September for the new process, and that will be evaluated to assess resource requirements and whether it's workable, etc. So that was September. That is ongoing, and I think, you know, we just need to wait to see what the outcome of that is. There's the Short Life Strategic Leadership Group reporting to ministers through a cross-portfolio ministerial group for prisoner health and social care. So I think there are things happening as a result of our last meeting with Jill Emery, and I think, you know, it's easy to cherry pick things that maybe still have to be implemented, but I think the wheels are definitely turning now, and I hope, you know, I hope that comes to a good conclusion.
Okay, thank you, Polly McNeill.
Thank you very much. First of all, it is quite hard when you're reading through these papers to get a sense of, well, what are we addressing here, because I'm trying to just focus my mind on the deaths in custody that I know about, where there's either been a suicide or, in fact, a death. So of the 86 deaths, would be helpful just to get a profile of, you know, what is, you know, what are the causes of these deaths, because I don't know if we can really make an assessment about whether or not the response is adequate enough. I mean, I'll be honest, reading through it, it was just so much management speak that's driving me nuts, trying to get to what are you actually trying to say to the committee, to be perfectly honest. I would say, on a positive note, I think that, and I'd like to examine it more, what Theresa Medhurst said in her letter about contact with families is actually quite a critical step. Because if you think of the case of Katie Allen and actually William Brown, their families were concerned about them. They knew that their family members were at risk, and it was phoning the prison and not getting answers. I think there was one of the issues, from my recollection. So I think it'd be worth following that up with Theresa Medhurst about the installation, how's it going to work, and make an assessment will make a difference, because I do think that could make a difference. I do agree with Russell Finlay in the sense that I think Jill Emery is one of the best witnesses we've ever had, because she doesn't pull her punches at all. We've got a horrendous record in deaths in custody. I mean, it's a problem for Scotland's prisons that we're detaining people, and I imagine it must be even more difficult now for the prison service, given the numbers. I actually feel quite concerned about that, and for the running of the service. So I do think it's a really important aspect of the work that the committee does. So in summary, Convener, I would like to see a profile of these 86 deaths, what were the causes, further information about the installation of family assistance and information. And also, I do agree that Jill Emery should be able to continue her work until we're satisfied that we've made significant enough progress to try and prevent further deaths in the Scottish Prison Service.
OK, thank you very much. John Swinney.
Thanks, Convener. I think on Pauline's point about the information on the fatalities within the prison service, I have a recollection that we saw some of that data either from Jill Imrie or the Scottish Prison Service, because I think it is important to understand the circumstances and the context, because you know, there will be different circumstances surrounding deaths in custody. Some will be because of suicide. Some will be because of wider health, other health issues. But the management of those other health issues is important to ensure that prisoners are being properly supported with the healthcare that they require when they are incarcerated. There's a fundamental commitment in terms of the human rights of prisoners. So I think it is important that we are assured that in both of these very different circumstances, support to individuals to support their well-being, to try to avoid circumstances where people take their own lives, or that prisoners are actually getting access to the proper healthcare to which they are entitled. So these are the kind of issues that lie at the heart of the work that Jill Imrie has been looking at. And I think, you know, I agree with colleagues that Jill Imrie was a very strong and a compelling witness in explaining the work that she's tried to do. I think, having said that, I think I take a slightly different view of the letters. You know, I don't question the fact that there is more that needs to be done here. So therefore, I would encourage some clarity on whether Jill Imrie is staying on, is being invited to stay on in post, because this work is not complete yet. So there's more that needs to be done. I have to say, I take a different view of the letters that have come from the Cabinet Secretary, the Chief Executive of NHS Scotland and the Chief Executive of the Scottish Prison Service, that I think they demonstrate there is work underway here. There might not be as much as the committee would like or that Jill Imrie would like, but it's underway. There is clear commitment to taking forward this agenda, but it might not be moving as fast as everybody would like to see. So for that reason, again, I think it's important that Jill Imrie is still able to continue the work that she's carried out. I think the last point I would make is that there is an issue that comes out of this, which is a crossover into other areas of responsibility, which is around the approach to fatal accident inquiries. And I think in that respect, the only answers, you know, we can ask the government for certain points, but fundamentally we need to hear from the Crown about these questions. And so, you know, I think as part of what we do in response to this material is that we should put some of this to the Crown and ask for a response to these points. Thank you, Camilla.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Some very relevant and helpful points made. I think across, I suppose, two key areas. One was the sort of terms of the review and the report that led to the work undertaken by Jill Imrie. And then I think very understandably, and I would certainly put myself in this category, some perhaps wider questions and concerns about issues that were not specific to the report, but nonetheless, for example, what brings someone to the point that they become one of the statistics in and around deaths in custody. And I think we've helpfully looked at some of that. So thank you, members, for all your points. I probably land with John Swinney and Rona in that I did take some reassurance from the submissions that we received, but in terms of some of the points that Sharon made around timescales, pinning that down a little bit. I acknowledge that was missing in some of the correspondence. So can I suggest to members and seek your agreement that we will follow up the points that have been made and the requests for some further information. It's obviously an issue that it's appropriate for us to keep under review, and I would also propose that we engage again with Jill Imrie for an update on her current situation. Obviously, in the correspondence, I think from the Cabinet Secretary, we were made aware that she has engaged with Jill Imrie. So there is quite a bit for us to take away. And I think the final point was the one that you made, John Swinney, in relation to some further correspondence with the Crown Office and Fiscal Service. So are members in agreement on that?
Yes,
Russell?
I'm very quick. I'm going to have a huge amount of time, but I think we absolutely need to go back to Jill Imrie in response to these letters. And also, I've made the point already, the Crown Office chose not to engage with us despite the criticism of them. And this, despite all the thousands upon thousands of words, this boils down to she's made one main recommendation which has been ignored. We need the authorities to come clean on that. Are they intent on doing it or are they not? Because...
Can I just clarify, are you referring to the first recommendation around the establishment of an independent process?
That's our main fundamental point of the report. But she was on to say if fatal accident inquiry system was fixed as she sees it, that wouldn't even be needed. So central to everything.
Yeah, in terms of the existing FAI process as compared to... Yeah.
And that's why I'm quite surprised the Crown Office, having heard that evidence in quite strong terms, haven't engaged with us.
Mm-hmm. So,
can I come in on that? Because I think what Russell Finlay said helps to, in a sense, tease out what we need to do practically here. I'm not firm in my view, and actually I don't think Jill Imrie is, that there is a need for a new system, providing the FAI system works as all of us would believe it should do. So I think we have to... I think there's a course of action that we need to take here. I certainly couldn't sign up to a new system. I'm quite in favour of people doing what they should be doing. So I'd rather go into this to explore what is the... what's the position on FAIs? What's the Crown's view? What improvements can be secured before we essentially align ourselves with a new system argument, type of proposition. So I think the going to the Crown, establishing what the FAI approach is I think the first base for us in pursuing this issue. I also think beyond going to, I think it will be important to hear Jill Imrie's view on all of this because she was a compelling witness and she's done a huge amount of work here. But I think we also need to hear from the government if Jill Imrie is being invited to continue in her role, because Jill Imrie can't... Well, if she's been asked to do it, then she can tell us, but we really need we need that confirmation from the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you.
Very quickly, yeah, indeed. I mean, that point was made during the evidence session but wasn't addressed in the letter from the government, so it does need to be clarified. Whether she'd take it is another matter.
Okay, thank you. I think Pauline and then Katie Clark.
Yeah, it was just on this point about FAIs. I mean, it's back to this profile of the 86 deaths, so it only applies to a few cases. But in the case of Alan Marshall, the family were distraught because they felt there was a cover-up and they couldn't get in to get any information about how Alan had died. And you know that there was immunity from prosecution and the Lord Advocate's taken that forward now. But one of the recommendations was that the family should get unfettered access to prison to get information about how their loved ones died, because previously they haven't been. So they have to wait to the FAI. And if the FAI takes years, then they get no real answers or contact. So every question I've had on this, I've asked that same question. Will they get unfettered access? And I do appreciate, well, can you make that commitment and at the same time not compromise where there might be an allegation of criminality, such as in this case? Can you make such a commitment and not interfere with the Crown doing their jobs? I've never had an answer to that. So I would just, in answer to John Swinney about FAIs, yeah, if the system worked, and let's see if we can make FAIs shorter. But you do have this other scenario where there's a death, such as the death of Alan Marshall. I do think families should get unfettered access to go and speak to prison governors, see where he died, all of that. Why shouldn't they? Why shouldn't, when the state has detained that person, why should they be blocked from finding out as much as they would like to know about their loved one's death? And I haven't had any answers to that, but I mean, I do feel quite strongly about that in cases, which I realise is a tiny percentage of the cases.
Thank you, Pauline.
Can you forgive me? I think what we discussed as a committee, I think we may have done it in private when we looked at some of the timescales for FAIs. There did appear to be a pattern that prison-related FAIs took longer than many other FAIs to be commenced, which I think does relate to the point, the serious point that Pauline McNeill raises about the Alan Marshall case. I think that's a reasonable issue to put again to the Crown, because I don't know the answer. Instinctively, I agree with the point that families should have unfettered access to information, but I don't know how that sits alongside proper investigation about the potential for criminality. So I think these are legitimate issues that we need to explore.
Okay, thank you. Katie Clark.
Yeah, I mean, it seems to me there's two issues. The first is how we reduce the numbers of deaths in custody, and then the second is the systems that are in place when there has been a death in custody. From my experience elsewhere, it does seem that greater political oversight can have an impact on deaths in custody and the numbers, which I actually have been quite surprised about. So I think the scrutiny of ministers, but also this committee, is really important in this area. And I agree with the points in relation to the issues around about what happens thereafter. The recommendations need to be implemented, but it's not necessarily the case that we need a completely different system. I think that would be quite a significant decision and one that we would need to scrutinise very, very carefully.
Okay, thank you, members, for those additional points. And just, Katie, I think you mentioned, I think, Pauline, just at the early part of your comments, some queries about numbers of deaths, and clerks have helpfully had a wee look at that during our discussion. Between 2012 and 2022, there were, as Jill Imrie also pointed out in committee, 350 deaths in Scottish prisons. About half of those were either through suicide or drug-related, and the other half were as a result of natural causes. So I think that just reflects the extent. So thanks very much. As I say, we will do some follow-up in terms of the points made today. Obviously, I think members are agreed that we very much keep this under review, and we will communicate also with Jill Imrie in relation to her status, and also the Crown Office, as has been suggested as well. Okay, thank you, members. So our next agenda item is to review correspondence received on the implementation of the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act of 2018. Members will recall that we undertook a short post-legislative review of this Act and have been following up issues with the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs. And paper 2 sets out the details of this and the Cabinet Secretary's most recent reply. So again, I open it up to members to make any comments. anybody want to come in at all? Anybody happy with the... Yep.
First,
Trying to find the right page,
yeah. So on page... I'll just read it from my notes, but on page 15 of one of the documents, there are statistics from Police Scotland about the number of domestic crimes reported to them. And I think it would be helpful to know, of all those reported, how many were subsequently reported to the Crown Office, and of that number, what happened next? So, of those reported, how many were diverted from prosecution and how many were prosecuted, and then what the conviction rate was? Because it's all very well saying the Act has been successful if you judge it on the number of cases reported, but if we don't know what consequently happened, and whether that's, you know, we don't know if it's a success or it's just disappearing into a bit of a kind of black hole. So I think that would be quite useful data to try and acquire if we can. There's also on page 18 a contribution from the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, and they seem to be making a virtue of the Aberdeen pilot for the Domestic Abuse Court. And from memory, from evidence the committee's already heard, I think that court, it was quite difficult for us to acquire information, and when we eventually did, I think from memory there was only something in the region of a dozen or so cases that had ever gone ahead. And so rather than it being some kind of success as it's been presented, it seems to have been underused, and the numbers were so low as to not be able to draw very much in the way of a conclusion from it.
I think if my memory is right, that some of those queries related to the number of cases that were, or trials that were undertaken in a virtual format.
Yeah, I think it was... They were virtual in their entirety, being was the purpose of the pilot.
Yeah.
But I think from what we could establish, due to reluctance from the accused and their lawyers, that often was not happening. Absolutely. And that might have explained, call me cynical, why it took us so long to establish that it had been used so infrequently. But, you know, for it then to pop up in a letter as some kind of evidence of good work in progress just seems questionable.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anybody else want to come in? Sharon, do you want to come in?
Yeah, so just a small comment. I wasn't obviously in the committee when the report was put out, so I'm not as expert as everybody else in the committee is. Just going through some of the responses and everything again, it was... Back to my previous comment, was more about timescales and actions. So I've heard a lot about the Caledonian system, which seems to get a lot of good press. But the other bit is the Justice Partners Roundtable. So again, it's kind of saying you'll be discussing over the next 12 months, there's going to be a lot of consideration and exploring and look, but there doesn't ever seem to be any firm actions or timescales for when things are going to be implemented. And I suppose in the kind of area that we're talking about, the quicker we go and put in the recommendations from what the experts are telling us is working, then the quicker we'll see results and the quicker we'll see improvements within the justice system for the people that most need it. So in that, again, it's probably timescales and actions rather than... It just seems to be people talking about things rather than actually doing things.
OK. Russell, you want to come back in?
Another point I forgot to mention. In response, her response to the Cabinet Secretary's letter to our questioning of an awareness campaign. So when the Act was first came into force, there was a publicity campaign to let people know what it did. And this was quite helpful, apparently. And we asked whether there was plans to do something else. And in response, she says that we are currently undertaking something called insight gathering. And then in the further documentation from... I think it's Scottish Government, page 13. Let me find it, sorry. They also use the phrase insight gathering. And I just wonder whether it's worth trying to establish if there are any concrete plans. I don't quite know what that means. I mean, they're either seeking to do something or they're not, I think. It's a small point.
Okay. Okay, anything else?
No, that's
at the moment. Anyone else? We can certainly follow that up. That's a fair point to raise, because I think...
Sorry, just for context, page 13, insight gathering, which could inform a future approach to communications. So, I mean, if they don't have any plans, just say so, you know. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We'll take that away. Okay, Rona Mackay.
Just very briefly, I mean, in the Cabinet Secretary's letter, she's talking about the round table and working group, which are meeting again in November this month, and she's going to feedback the outcome of the discussion, including the finalised terms of reference for the group, and she'll share it with us. So I think we just expect that to be imminent, I think. Yeah.
Thanks very much. Thanks for those comments. Again, I think, you know, I am encouraged by a lot of what is going on, different tasks and areas of work take different lengths of time, obviously. I was particularly interested in the update that we asked about regarding the single court judge model. There's a lot in that, but I thought that was quite helpful to have that set out. So we'll take some of the points that have been raised away, and I would just ask for members' agreement that we continue to monitor this particular issue. That's highly appropriate that we do that. One final...
Sorry, just when you mentioned the thing about the single sheriff for civil criminal cases, which I'd raised a few times, I just found some of the reasons against that to be slightly questionable, if not spurious. Some of them seemed valid, but... yeah, watch the space. I think they're looking at it. So, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much. So, that concludes our business in public today. Next week, we will begin phase two of our scrutiny of the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill, when we will take evidence on part four. This is the part of the bill which deals with the proposed abolition of the not proven verdict and changes to jury majorities. So thank you, and we'll now move into private session.